In the name of one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Please be seated. And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." I love Easter. It has an unexpected wildness to it, a kind of playful power of change that wants to upset the rigid places in us. Makes me think of Robert Frost's poem, Mending Wall, which begins this way: "Something there is that doesn't love a wall, that sends the frozen ground swell under it and spills the upper boulders in the sun and makes gaps even two can pass abroad." Easter presents us with the question, will you allow God to change your mind? That's an important question, because in order to love as Jesus wishes, we must be willing to change our minds about how we choose to relate to others and even to ourselves. Will you allow God to change your mind? Once I had some real difficulty with not hating a parishioner who was actively hostile and nasty toward me. My wise spiritual director told me to go home and think about how I could change my mind about that person. So I went home and stewed about it for days. The guy was just an absolute jerk, a total blankety-blank. I simply could not stand the man. After worrying myself out hating this person and walking around the house calling him names, it came to me, amazingly, that maybe he wasn't actually totally any of those things. So reluctantly, I sat down and I made a list of other things he was besides a rotten, blankety-blank jerk. Well, I said to myself grudgingly, he really does love his elderly mother. He takes wonderful care of her, and he takes her out for fun a lot, much more than most people would. Fine, I said to myself, he's still a jerk. Well, what else is he? I admitted grudgingly that he really was very warm and helpful to me when I first arrived at the church, and he was wonderful with the street people we served dinner to downtown. And I had forgotten that he also spent a lot of time helping me to understand this very different community I was entering, and he helped them to work with me. As I called to mind these and other things about the man, I discovered a funny thing. He seemed much nicer and more human than before. I even saw where we began to diverge in our relationship. I realized after a while that I had stopped seeing him as a person somewhere along the line. He had become just a jerk. In order for us to continue living and working in the same parish, I needed to change my mind about him and see him as a complete, full human being, beloved of God. He couldn't be beloved of God, right? Don't we regularly and often thoroughly dehumanize people we disagree with, or those who we feel hurt us, or who are so different from us in so many ways? a blankety blank, and she's not even worth the effort to like or to get to know. I definitely wouldn't invite him to coffee. What have we learned about others from our culture, our religion, and our upbringing? Have we allowed God to change our beliefs and attitudes toward others over the years? You're not five anymore. But it can be hard. I grew up in a very liberal family, and my mother was a newspaper writer and an editor in a highly educated and fairly sarcastic work environment. I thought that that was the way everybody thinks. I was so shocked when at lunch in seminary one day, the woman across from me who was a conservative Republican suddenly said to me, "You know, Betsy, not everyone thinks the same way you do." And she got up and left. Boy, I was so shocked. That never occurred to me. Of course everybody is liberal and sarcastic. That's great, it's fun. Since then I have met and worked with and learned from some very fine people of conservative Republican persuasion. And I have found that for me, listening to people who are very different from me helps balance my thinking and my worldview. For a long time, I was terrified to talk to people in congregations about Buddhism or Muslim faith. I got over that, but I don't know, are Muslims and Buddhists going to hell? Is it okay to talk about that? They're different. They're so conditioned by the water we swim in. Sometimes people have been reared in a family where church formed their vision of God at an early age, and their faith has remained exactly the same faith they knew as a child. For some people, changing that faith is terrifying, and maybe you've met people that who are like that. They're afraid because maybe God would hate them, or maybe their family would not approve and would stop loving them. But now that faith leaves them unable to stretch to see others who do not believe as they do as beloved of God or worthy of respect and compassion. It can be very difficult to love others if we cannot allow God to change our minds. Peter's story in Acts this morning is a wonderful example of a person so bound to the faith he has followed all his life that he struggles to include others rejected by his culture and faith for centuries. Gentiles were the bottom of the rung. You didn't deal with Gentiles if you were a Jew. Didn't have anything to do with them. The apostles, however, heard rumors that some Gentiles had also accepted the word of God. So Peter went up to Jerusalem to meet with them and to preach to them about Jesus and the way. But before he met with these Gentiles, Peter would never have wanted to meet or eat with them or give to these outcasts the good news of Jesus that was emerging. Wouldn't have done it. He would have felt unfaithful as a devout Jew, a traitor to his religion. But while he was praying one day, he had a vision of all the ritually unclean animals Gentiles ate being lowered toward him on a sheet. And a voice told him to kill and eat them. "Oh, no, Lord, I couldn't. I have never eaten anything forbidden. I am a man of faith, and I am faithful to that faith." And then the voice said, "What God says is clean to eat, you must not call profane." And the Spirit told Peter to go to the Gentile man from Caesarea and not to make any distinction between himself and his companions. That was unheard of. No distinction to be made between them and himself and his companions. So Peter allowed God to change his mind. And he did go to the Gentiles and he preached to them about Jesus and the way, just as he would have to circumcised Jews that they believed. As our world becomes even more hateful and fearful and violent, the question is, even for us faithful ones, will we allow God to change our minds? Will we? Will we welcome with open arms and hearts Buddhists and Muslims and Hindus and native peoples and street people and evangelical Christians and Democrats and Republicans and independents and kids and old people and people from other cultures and people with disabilities and people from different races and the guy who was so rude this morning at the store and the woman who cut in front of my bumper this morning or the person who hurt us? Will we allow God to change our minds enough to see all these other ones as full and complete human beings, lovely in God's eyes, and worthy of respect and compassion and friendship and blessing? Will we? And the one who was seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." And Jesus said, "I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you're my disciples, if you have love for one another."